you're going to receive a great word this morning, just hearing about how God is using him. This is his first time here in Orleans, and I want you to give a big community welcome as Ilya Bantseev comes this morning.
Pastor, good morning. Good morning. It's nice to to be back in Canada. I'm flying back to Russia tomorrow. And my wife is saying hello to you. We have four children that have grown up on the mission field, and now they've gone to college. And one of our daughters finished college this year, and she came back to work with us. She graduated from Valley Forge University in Pennsylvania with a digital media degree. And she was doing the internship in one of the large churches in the United States. They offered her a job, and she says, "No, I already have a job." They said, "Where?" She said, "In Siberia." "How much are they paying you?" "Nothing," she said. "Are you sure?" She said, "Yes." So she came to work with us. This morning, I'd like to thank you so much for having me come to your Mission Sunday. And I like your logo, "Everyone Go." Is that what it says on your mission's logo? So... first of all, I want to thank you for participating in Samaritan Purse Project. I'll tell you a short story. I oversee Teen Challenge Ministry in Eurasia region, and one of the countries is Tajikistan. It's a former Soviet Union republic. It's a Muslim nation. Now it is its own country. And I was visiting the pastor who does Teen Challenge work in Tajikistan. And as we drove into a village where he's building at Teen Challenge Center, all of a sudden I see kids running from the sides, from side streets, running behind that van. And I'm saying, "What's going on? Are they your relatives?" He says, no, "These are the kids from the neighborhood. You'll see what happens." So when he stopped, they surrounded him, and he opens the van and he pulls out boxes with those shoe boxes, Samaritan Purse boxes, and gives it to everyone. And then he told me that every summer he has a camp. Over 100 kids come to his day camp, and he's reaching to his parents that are totally Muslim. So this helps. So I appreciated the prayer of two little girls today that each box would be, given to specific hands, and that God will use each box. I've seen that happen in Tajikistan. So thank you for getting involved in that. Now, let me tell you a little bit about myself. I was born in the Soviet Union and grew up there. I grew up in the underground Pentecostal church. So my mother told me a story when I was just born. That was 50 years ago, 1969. I was born in February. She went to church on Easter Sunday that year. It was in April. There was a lot of snow still. And she wrapped me up in a few blankets, and she went into the service. The service was in one of the homes of the believers on the outskirts of the city. So in the middle of the service, the police come in, and the KGB stopped the service, and they told all the men to go into the side room, and all the women were let go home. My mother was putting her boots on, and the officer stopped her and says, "No, you stay too." And he told her to go into the side room where the men were. The reason they wanted to keep the man was because KGB knew that all the men in the church are trained to preach. The training was very simple. The service would begin in a house, and the pastor would look around and say, "Hey, brother, you'll be preaching first this morning, and you will be preaching second." And he'll look around and says, "You will be third, and I'll finish the service." So there'll be like four mini sermons. So the KGB knew that everyone preaches, and so they wanted to arrest all the men. The reason they asked my mother to stay, not asked, they told her to stay, was because the propaganda in those days was that Pentecostal sect is the most vicious because they sacrifice babies on Easter Sunday and they drink their blood. So for this officer who was brainwashed, everything made sense. You know, he's an Easter Sunday service in the sect, and he's a woman with a newborn, so he asked her to stay. So as my mother went into that room, she overheard the men were whispering to one another. They were saying, "What are we going to do with the Bibles? Bibles were very, very difficult to get in the Soviet Union. They had to be smuggled in across the border illegally. And so my mother quickly laid her baby on the bed, opened all the blankets, and took four or five Bibles from the man and put them in between the layers under my back and quickly wrapped me back up. She was a brave woman. She was only 26 at the time. And as soon as she did that, the officer walks in into the room and he says to her, "Unwrap the baby." Well, she thought that she was caught, but she, in a split second, had a thought that she should open all the blankets at once so he wouldn't see what's in between the layers. So she opened up all the blankets, and he just wanted to make sure that the baby is still alive, that I wasn't sacrificed already. So he checked my breathing. He said, "Okay, wrap him back up." And he called another man and said, "Take this woman outside into the truck. She's going to the police station with us." She was going to be arrested. So because my mother was already in her boots and her coat, she quickly went outside the house, and she noticed that the man wasn't following her immediately. So she quickly ran around the corner and across the road, and she escaped. Now, before she ran out, the officer asked her last name, so she told him. He wrote it down. And my mother escaped, and she was still concerned that, you know, they had her last name. Now, there was a court case afterwards, and the pastor was sentenced to 3 years in prison. But the prosecutor, as he reported to the judge, he said there was a woman with a newborn baby, and he read her last name. And the believers who were present in that court case, in that court hearing, said that he read a totally wrong name. So either the angel did something to his ears and he heard wrong, or maybe he scribbled it wrong, but the name was not written correctly, and so they didn't find my mother. And if they had found her, and if they had found that she hid the Bibles in the blankets of the baby, she would have been sentenced to 10 years in prison for hiding anti-Soviet literature, and she would be taking the parental rights away and from her and my father, and the children would be taken out and sent to different orphanages to be raised by the state. Well, God has protected my parents. He's protected me. He obviously had a different plan for my life. And I tell the story, and I tell that that's when God called me to preach, when I was laying on the Bibles. So this was back in those days. But 30 years ago, my family moved from the Soviet Union, from Novokuznetsk, to Canada, and we came to London, Ontario. But I only lived in London for 4 years, and as soon as I became a Canadian citizen, I went back with my wife and our first-born baby. He was 1 year old. We went back to my hometown where I was born, where I grew up. I felt the church had prayed for decades for freedom to come, and the freedom is now here, and it's not right that the Christians are leaving, because back in those days, the end of the 80s and the beginning of the 90s, all the way to year 2000, tens of thousands of families moved from the Soviet Union and then from Russia to United States, to Canada, and I felt, you know, this is not right. God has given us the freedom to preach, finally, and Christians are leaving, so my family was not so happy that I decided to go, but they blessed us, and my wife and I went back to Novokuznetsk 26 years ago, and I'm so glad we went. I'm so glad we felt this call, and we obeyed the call, because looking back, I see that it was the hand of God that brought us to Novokuznetsk, Siberia, and I'd like to show you a short video right now, what's going on. We have planted a church. And we started Teen Challenge Ministry. We do orphanage ministry. We reach out to so many people, and the church keeps on growing. And it's only by the grace of God, because there's so much opposition as well. And so on this video, you will see our own mission conference or church planting conference. And you will see people responding to the call to go on to missions. And then you will see our first satellite. This year we opened our first satellite in the different section of town, and we feel God has called us to start a satellite church every year on Easter Sunday. And so on Easter 2020, we're praying that God will help us to start another one. And so we'll do until 2024, so that six churches will be right in the city. That's how we will effectively reach the whole city. So it'll be about the new satellite. And the third part of this video will be just our church's celebration with baptismal service. So if we could just watch the video, please.
Да, Господь, мы сегодня в присутствии Твоем. Мы ощущаем Твою любовь. Ты так возлюбил каждого из нас. Иисус, слава Тебе, что Ты пришел на миссию сюда, на землю. И Ты поручил нам идти и делать учеников из всех народов. Аллилуйя! Мы славим Тебя, Иисус. Сегодня мы благодарим Тебя, что Ты призвал нас, Ты позвал, и мы пошли, Господь дорогой. Слава Тебе! Даруй каждому сегодня ощутить вот это состояние срочности, состояние страха Божьего, чтобы, Господи, нам в точности исполнить все, что Ты повелеваешь нам. Благослови нас, Боже мой, и не дай нам, Господи, где-то застрять, не дай нам успокоиться, Господи, но производи в нас свои хотения и действия по воле Своей. Я молю Тебя, Дух Святой, сегодня, сегодня, сейчас производи свою работу и даруй народу Твоему упорство и неотступность. Господь, чтобы никакие трудности, никакие проблемы нас не остановили, Господь дорогой. Я прошу Тебя, говори сегодня к сердцу многих людей. Говори, Господь дорогой, я ободряю, Боже мой, Дух Святой, совершай, совершай свою работу в сердце народа Твоего, в сердце тех, которые сегодня посвятили себя служению, благовестия, служению миссионерству. Аллилуйя! Аллилуйя! Слава Тебе, Господь!
So this is just a little bit of highlights for this year. And by the grace of God, since we started the missions program, our own missions program in Siberia, since the year 2000, we started 25 other churches all throughout Siberia. But we feel that God has called us to do much better, much greater. And by 2030, we received this vision from God, and we set this goal for ourselves, for all the church plants that we already have, that together, using all the resources that we have and the resources that God will give us from outside Russia, by the year 2030, we want to have 200 churches in Siberia and in Russia. And those 25 that we already planted, most of them have been started by Teen Challenge graduates. It's the people that were on drugs or involved in alcohol, and God set them free, and they want to be trained, and they want to be used of God. So as you pray for Russia, I would like to invite you, and I'd like to ask you to consider to come and visit Siberia. I know it's far away. It's on the other side of the globe, exactly on the other side. Like right now, it's 11:30 in the morning. It's 11:30 Sunday night in Novokuznetsk. They've already done their services. See, we live in the future from you guys, 12 hours. And if you come to Siberia, you will have fulfilled the commandment that Jesus said, go to the ends of the earth. See, Siberia is not quite the end, but you could see it from there. So talk to your pastor. We'd love to have a team from CPC. We invite teams every year, and sometimes Canadians come, and we have so many opportunities. Like, we've had a soccer camp last summer. Four Canadian girls from Ontario came and did a 5-day soccer camp for the boys in Siberia. And after they left, four guys came to Christ, and they are now attending church and attending home groups. And we want to do it every year. So if you want to do soccer camp, or you want to do media workshop, or you're a high-tech individual that will help with those things, you know, we invite everybody. Even like hockey, we've had hockey, two teams from Canada come back in 1999 and in 2004, and it's about time to have another one. It's already 2019, but hockey is like, it's like an idol in Russia, same in Canada, right? But Russians love hockey, and when we had those two teams, we had open doors everywhere to go to schools, universities, to share the gospel with kids, and so we invite you to come. Let me show you a few more pictures, just to show you some of the faces from Russia, from Siberia, from our church, people that have been saved. And as you look at them, I want you to just picture that people like that live right here in Ottawa. People just like that live maybe next door to you, or as you see them as you go to work. So God wants to use you to reach those people. So you can go across the world, across the ocean to Siberia, or go across the road. But everyone must go. I like your motto of the Mission Sunday. So let's turn on the... Yes, this is my wife, Janet. She's sending her greetings. She's saying hello. I spoke to her this morning when she already went home after the last service that we had in Siberia. She couldn't make it to come, but she's sending hello to you. Next slide. Here I am doing the wedding for Dima and Uliana. We have a joke. Finally, Dima married his wife. Well, because Dima and Uliana lived for about 20 years together, not married, had four kids. Dima was a desperate alcoholic. And finally, when he came out of prison, he was even worse than ever before. His wife left him, and Dima came into our Teen Challenge program. After completing the program, the Lord just really set him free and put a desire in his life to go back to his own village, where he was known as a village drunkard. He was laying on the streets and everyone drunk, sometimes in his underwear, just embarrassing himself. But everyone knew Dima as a drunkard, and he said, "Pastor, train me. I want to go back and I want to start a church." So he went through a missionary training school, and I said, "Dima, it's good if your wife gets saved and if you go together." So we prayed, and then his wife started attending church. In 6 months, she received Christ. And then a few months later, he proposed to her, and she accepted his proposal. So I'm marrying them here. And they're ministering now with their kids in the village just north of Novokuznetsk. And we have kids from that village come every year to our church camp. So next slide, please. Here we have a young man by the name Valera. Valera is an orphan, and through our orphanage ministry, God saved him. And so he went through a seminar on how to share the gospel. Now, there was a home assignment to go home and share with two people. Well, he comes back the next day and says, "Pastor, I shared with four of my friends, and all of them received Christ. And not only that, I shared with two teachers, and they also received Christ." So here we have this young evangelist, and he said that, "Pastor, pray for me, because next year I'm graduating from the orphanage, and I want to share with every boy and girl, with every teacher in that orphanage," and that's a few hundred people. So we're so happy that Valero is saved. On this picture, facing us, this young man, his name is Max. This is in the city of Krasnoyarsk. Krasnoyarsk is just 1,000 kilometers east of Novokuznetsk. That's a large city, over 1 million people. We had a conference there for Teen Challenge Ministry. the two men talking to Max are Teen Challenge staff members from Kyrgyzstan. After the conference, they decided to go to the mall and buy fur hats for one of our American guest speakers. And so they use their cell phones to get directions. And so they're walking like this on the streets, and they run into Max. Well, Max was waiting for drugs because he ordered drugs, and he was so sure that these people are walking toward him. They're delivering the dose for him. So they run into each other, and he says, "Where's the stuff?" And they knew immediately what he was asking for because they were former drug addicts. So they started sharing with him. They brought him to the hotel where we stayed, and I asked them, "Did you pray with Max?" They said, "No." I asked Max, "Would you like to pray?" He said, "Yes." So as he repeated the prayer after me, all of a sudden the Holy Spirit just fell right on that spot all over him. He starts literally shaking and sweating and weeping like a child. Like he yelled at me, "What are you doing to me?" I said, "I'm not doing anything. You're just repeating the prayer." So right then in the hotel lobby, Max agreed to come into our Teen Challenge program in Novokuznetsk. If you turn to the next slide, please. That's Max today. He wants to stay and minister. He's graduating like next Sunday when I'm in Novokuznetsk. We'll be praying for Max. And he went through the training in Royal Rangers. So he wants to train young kids and teenagers to be disciples of Christ. Next slide. This young lady's name is Yana. Yana was in prison for about 18 years. He was a professional thief, a drug addict. Everyone in the prison knew her. The authorities actually consulted with her because she ran the prison on the inside. She had ladies that, you know, obeyed her orders. One time, a girl who was with Yana in the prison when she was sent home after her sentence, she got saved. That girl's name is Anya. So Anya prayed, and the Lord put on her heart to pray for Yana and to share Christ with her. So Anya called the prison and made an appointment with Yana. And as she was telling her about Jesus, Yana was kind of very hard in her heart and said, "Is this all you wanted to tell me?" She said, "Yes." And said, "One other thing. God loves you so much," she said, "that he put your name into my heart, and I prayed for you for months." Well, that really touched Yana, that God put her name into Anya's heart. So a few months later, Yana, she asked Anya to come back and tell her more about Jesus. Well, a long story short, Yana accepted the Lord. The Lord set her free from drug addiction right there during her prayer in the prison. So she goes back to her barrack and she says to her girls, "I'm no longer using drugs. I don't need that." And they were all shocked. Well, today, all of those girls that were with Yana, all of them are saved. But Yana is now overseeing the women's prison ministry in our church. She goes twice a month and speaks one-on-one to the ladies, and many of them are receiving Christ. They also do ministry to the children whose mothers are in prison. They give gifts similar to a Samaritan purse. We do some offerings in Russia and buy gifts for kids for Christmas and the children's Bible. So if you go to the next slide, that's what they do. Here's Yana and her friend Natasha, and they're visiting kids, giving them the gifts, and the kids then send their pictures and their videos to their mothers in prison. So next slide. On this picture, Natasha and Vanya, this is a young couple in our church that we have a nickname. We say this is the couple that's raised from the dead. Vanya was a heroin addict for over 10 years, and one day he was found overdosed on the floor of his apartment building entrance. The neighbors called the ambulance. The ambulance came, checked his pulse, and they wrote a statement, "He's dead," and they called the morgue to come and pick up the body. So the neighbors told Vanya's brother. Vanya's brother, who lived in the same apartment building, was just saved. He was a new believer. So Vanya's brother was driving behind the morgue vehicle, pleading with Jesus, "God," he says, "don't let my brother die and go to hell. give him another chance. So they brought Vanya's body, put him on a stretcher, covered him with a white sheet, ready to be transported to the morgue, and he was laying there for some time. And one of the nurses walking by noticed that there was a fresh blood stain on the white sheet. And the nurse immediately thought, dead bodies don't bleed. So she grabbed his hand, and there was pulse. They rushed him into the intensive care unit instead of the morgue. And in 20 days later, he comes out of the coma, and they told him what happened. And he called our Teen Challenge program asking for help. So we took Vanya in. So he's now free. The doctors told him and his wife they'll never be able to have children because of the problems that his wife had with her health. But they have two beautiful kids now, and they're overseeing home group ministry in our church. So let me tell you about Natasha, his wife. Natasha heard the gospel, but she was also a drug addict. And because of her addiction, her body was totally shot. The immune system was gone. And the last thing that she had was kidney failure. And so the doctors sent her home to die, and they said to the parents, be ready in a couple of days. Well, the parents brought her home, and they put her in the bedroom. The mother put a little icon in the corner of that bedroom. Natasha heard the gospel before, and she knew that she can just pray to Jesus from her heart. And as she was dying, she said, Jesus, I know I wasted my life. She asked for forgiveness. She asked if Jesus would cleanse her. And then she said, Jesus, if you give me a chance, I want to serve you. I will commit my life to you for the rest of my days. Well, the next day she felt a little bit better, and she started going to the bathroom. Her kidneys began to work. And so the mother called us, and we took Natasha. She was so sick she couldn't walk. Her body was bloated with fluids. Well, we just prayed for her, and she started getting better and better. Well, there she is right now. She's a healthy young lady. The Lord healed her, and when she graduated from the program, she decided to go to get her driver's license. Well, in Russia, if you're a drug addict and you're in the system, in the medical system, then if you stop using drugs, you need to go to the doctor before you get your license. In the period of 5 years, you need to go get checked. So she started this process, and she decided to go and ask them to start her process of getting her driver's license. So she told the lady that she was a drug addict, and she gave her a name, and the doctor put her name in the computer. And Natasha says, the doctor looks at her and says, oh. She said, I'm so sorry. Natasha said, what's wrong? She says, our computer system says that you're dead. There's a date of your death. That was the date when they sent her home. They already said that she's finished, she's gone. And they put death date. Well, Natasha says, well, here I am. I'm not dead. I'm alive. The doctor was so apologetic, and she says, okay, give me your paper. I'll sign this. You don't need 5 years to check. You can go get your driver's license. So so that's Natasha and Vanya's story, the couple that's raised from the dead. Next slide. Okay, this is this man's name is Valera. Valera was involved in the mafia. I don't know much of what he did. All I just heard that he controlled the mafia that controlled the prisons, prison inmates, so in our region. Well, Valera's dad needed help because of his addiction to alcohol, and he approached us and said, can you help my dad? So we took his father. His father went through the program. He's now on staff with us. So Valera was very thankful. He came, but he was very stern looking, very Russian, no smile, you know, and just thank you guys for helping my dad. So we said, sure. Well, a couple of years later, we decided to buy a tractor for our Teen Challenge program. We had a piece of land, and so we needed a tractor. So we raised money, $35,000, to buy a brand new a tractor made in Belarus. It's called Belarus Tractor. So we found a company, we paid the money, we signed the contract. They said, in 2 weeks, you'll get your tractor. Well, 2 weeks go by, no tractor. So we called them and said, oh, please forgive us, in 2 weeks for sure. A month goes by, no tractor. And then 6 months go by. We paid the money, but there's no tractor. We asked the lawyers. The lawyers said, well, this is a sham firm. You can take them to court, but you will not get your money right away. It'll take years to get your money back. And we just thought, oh, man, we made a mistake by, you know, trying to do business with this company. So Valera's father said to me, Pastor, why don't you call my son? I said, okay. We called Valera. We told him the problem, and Valera sent two of his men to see the guy in charge of that firm. Very soon, we got our money back. I did not ask Valera what did they say to the guy. I did not want to know. I just thanked Valera. I said, thank you so much. And I invited him to come to church, and he came. He came with his father, and after the service, he comes up to me and he says, Pastor, this was a good sermon. I wanted to come forward, but I was a little shy. I said, well, let's go up to my office. So we went up to the office. I explained to him what it means to receive Christ. And I asked, Valera, would you like to pray? He said, yes. So as we prayed, his voice began to shake. He could hardly speak. And when he said amen, he looks at me and he says, Pastor, this is a miracle because I never cry. I said, well, God is touching your life. And Valera started coming to church regularly with his dad. And just this last day of Pentecost that we had this year, we had the altar call for people to receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Valera comes forward and God baptized him in the Holy Spirit. He starts speaking in tongues. He's a brand new believer. He is not even baptized yet. And he said to his friend who attends the church, the Teen Challenge director, he says, wow, I can't believe I can't stop speaking in tongues. So on this picture, Valera is with his wife, Julie. Well, Julie was very skeptical. And for a few weeks, Valera kept attending church. And we prayed for Julie. And I asked churches in Canada that know us to pray for Julie. Well, last night I got a text message from Teen Challenge director, and he said that Julie accepted the Lord. And so they're both now saved. This is a brand new couple in our church. So I want to challenge you. Go. Everyone must go. There are people around us just like this. Just like these people you saw on the presentation. I believe that Jesus is very, very attractive. And if we represent him in the right way, no one can turn him down. No one. People are broken. People are in need everywhere. And if we present Jesus to them the right way, and that's what we need to pray and ask God to lead us, how we can represent Christ. It's almost like we need to be awakened. We need to wake up because we're so used to do church. We're so used to do our ministry, so-called. We're so used to doing things the way we do that we don't see that there are people around us that are reaching out, crying out. And the Holy Spirit can awaken us, each one of us. And you may go across the road. You may go across the nation of Canada. Or you may go to Siberia, but everyone must go. I just want to read to you from Matthew 21, a parable. Matthew 21, if you turn to verse 28, Jesus gives this parable right before he goes to the cross. And he begins by asking a question. He says, what do you think? It's a very good parable, and I want you to think about it as we read, because Jesus asks us to think as he speaks this parable. What do you think? There was a man who had two sons. He went to the first and said, son, go and work today in the vineyard. I will not, he answered. but later he changed his mind and went. Then the father went to the other son and said the same thing. He answered, "I will, sir," but he did not go. Which of the two did what his father wanted? The first, they answered. I want to stop right there. Let's think about it. In this parable, I believe the father represents God, our heavenly father. And the two sons in this parable, it's the church. It's us. And so notice that the call of the father never changed. It was the same to the first son as to the second one. And let's think about it. What do you think the first one said right away, "I will not"? What do you think? Why did he say no to his father? Well, I think he said no to his father for the same reasons so many people today in the church say no when God says to them, "Go." Either they have their own plans or they have, you know, something other. Maybe they are afraid of difficulties, because working for God sometimes requires tenacity, and you need to be relentless working for God. So I want to pray this morning, because I know that in the church this size, there are people here today that are like this first son. God has called you, but you said no to him. I've had people come to me and say, "Pastor, I was called to the missions when I was in Sunday school." And I said, "And what happened?" "Well, I got married and have kids." I said, "So what? I also have a wife and kids." Another person comes up to me and says, "Pastor, I was called to missions, but then I got involved in the business." I said, "So what? God is not against your business. You can do business with the kingdom mindset and still either support the missions or go to missions, because there are so many people around the world that also do business that you can reach." What do you think? I want to pray that just as what happened with this son who first said no, then later he had a change of mind, he had a change of heart. I want to pray that the Holy Spirit will do the same thing, that not one of us here will say no to the Father. And also, I want to pray that none of us will be like the second son who says, "Yes, Father, I'll go to the ends of the earth." I don't know how in Canada, but in Russia, we have a lot of people that go to the conferences, they sing songs, and, you know, there are songs, "I will go to the ends of the earth." There are songs like that we sing, but they never go. They said yes to the call at the conference, yes to prayer, but they never go. And I want to pray that none of us will be in that position. So why don't we all stand? And I want to pray that the Holy Spirit will do a mighty work, and there will be a change of heart, a change of mind, that everyone goes. Everyone. Father, we thank you. We thank you this morning for how much you loved us. We thank you that you have called us into your kingdom. And you are asking all of us to go and work in your vineyard. And Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that you bless this church, young and old, teenagers, young families, and people who are retired. I pray that you would speak to each one. And let no one in this congregation be the ones that said no to you. Let there be a change of heart, a change of mind. So, Father, that we go across the road, across the nation, across the ocean, and we reach and share the gospel and present the gospel to the people, and help us to represent you in the right way, so that, Lord, people could not turn you down because you're so good. So, Father, I pray for this church that not one will be left on the side who would not do what you want, because you want everyone to go and work in your vineyard. Thank you, Father. Thank you for this opportunity. Thank you for this morning service. Thank you for all the people here that are involved in ministry, and I pray that each one will go, just like the theme of this Sunday. Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Pastor.